So, where I'm standing, I felt the presence of God. And I thought, He has touched you as well. So, don't let us be distracted. When Peter and John saw the man at the beautiful gate, they said, look at us. There's a need for us to focus on God. If you don't focus on Him, you get left behind. So when we come into God's presence, it's a spiritual house. We should focus on God and His Spirit. Because before the message itself comes the message, God Himself already began ministering to people individually. Then when we now make the altar call or testimony time, then people now begin to testify. He touched me. How? When? When we are all worshiping. So the moment you enter the auditorium, God is there. And He begins to minister to people. At times some people can see the angels of God going around. See? The other day it was a small child from the back of the auditorium that saw these huge objects, huge beings rather, all around, telling the mom, can you see? The mom said, and to the man of God said, the angels of God are here. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Anyway, we are all welcome in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's just start the service, the message. Let's have what the Lord has to say. Luke chapter 5, verses 1 to 6. Shall we all read together, please? So it was, as the multitude pressed about Him to hear the word of God, that He stood by the lake of Genesaret, and saw two boats standing by the lake, but the fishermen had gone from them, and were washing their nets. Then He got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the land. And He sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When He had stopped speaking, He said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your net for a catch. But Simon answered and said to Him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. Six, and when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. Today we are talking on from nothing to something. Verse 5. The second part was Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. Thank God they did. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their nets was breaking. Simon Peter had a career as a fisherman. Yet despite this, on this fateful day, he toiled all night, a professional fisherman. He toiled all night and caught nothing. From this story, we know what good fishermen do. They toil in the night. They go for fishing in the night because at that time they can get a lot of fish. But on this particular day, got nothing. And today many are in work. But despite this, we still have nothing to show for it. Doesn't that sound familiar? Like Simon Peter. Can God meet our needs if we have nothing? Peter and all his friends went for fishing, but nothing to catch. They did this all night, and so in the morning, what were they doing? They were busy washing their nets out of frustration. They had a busy night and nothing to show for it. They were frustrated and dejected and tired. But unbeknownst to them, their misfortune is about to change. Could that be somebody here? Unbeknownst to you, something is in the corner, just about to evolve. Verse 3. Then Jesus got into one of the boats. So there were two boats standing by the lake. He got into Simon's boat. Maybe the Lord will come into your own boat.
Amen.
Why Simon's boat? Why his own? Why not the other one? So he has a 50% chance. He literally borrowed Simon's boat to preach. What if God wants to borrow something from you that belongs to you? It could have been another boat, as I said, but this one was Simon's. What if the Lord wants to use what belongs to you to give you what you lack? And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. You know, Simon could have said an emphatic no, because rightly so, he got nothing. And he was now washing his net. And this gentleman said, came to his boat, "Can I use your boat to preach?" But thank God he didn't. Because he needed to wash his net at this time so as to get ready for tonight fishing. And then came Jesus, "Let's use your boat." But Simon did not refuse God, because he knew that tonight might be different from yesterday night. What was Simon doing when Jesus Christ was preaching in his boat? Anyone?
Listening.
He must have been listening. Thank you. And taking notes. Verse 3. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's. If God knows all things, he knew that Simon and his friends had toiled all night and caught nothing. And that was the reason why Jesus came to Simon. So, does God know what you are going through? Does God know that you're really behind time? There are certain things that have to be done this month, let alone this year. Because he knows all things. And he has to come, because this is how God can help. Verse 4. When he had stopped speaking, who?
Jesus.
He said to Simon, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." Every good tongue deserves
another.
The New International Bible said, "Put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch. Verse 5. But Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Frustrated. Doesn't that sound like a frustration?
Yeah.
He was complaining, as many of us do. And rightly so. As a professional fisherman, like others, fishermen, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. But that wasn't the case. That wasn't what Christ was instructed him to do. God understands our frustrations, but often when we are in need, He comes to our rescue by giving a personal instruction that can turn things around. Do I get an amen?
Amen!
Because God is not far from us, as some people think. In Him we live, in Him we have our being. Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, because you have said so, I will let down the net. This is powerful. This is what is called Rhema. A living word that came out of the blues to you is a word of wisdom. When all hope is gone, have you tried following the instruction, any of the instruction that God has given? When Abraham was 100 years old, I believe you all know Abraham. Contrary to hope, in hope, believed. Abraham believed that he will have the promised child. Even when physically speaking, he being 100 years old and his wife's womb was dead. He did not waver at the promise of God. This was exactly what Simon did. Though initially, he wanted to complain. He did complain. But said, nevertheless, at your word, because you have said so, I will. Contrary to hope, in hope, believed. Because all along, he had been listening attentively to this man of God preaching in my boat. God must be up to something. Can you suspect God? God will be up to something. Can anybody suspect God that God is up to something?
Yes.
Despite all these odds, God will be up to something.
Yes.
Verse 6. And when they had done this, hallelujah.
Amen.
What did they do? Peter and the other fishermen, they did not waver at the given instruction. Launch into the deep and let down your net for a catch. Because you need to catch. You need a catch at this time. I know your frustration and I've come to help you. Initially, he was complaining, but almost at the same time, he believed and did as he was told. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish and their nets was breaking. From nothing to something. From zero to hero. Between yesterday and this morning, they did as they were told. They believed and their condition improved. if they have done this long time before. But God is always on time. Can this be the pattern that God uses to answer our needs? Because if he has done it for somebody, he will do it for another person. But God is not partial. Can this be a pattern that God uses to meet our needs? And I call it a five-step pattern that God uses to meet our needs. Step one, he knows your frustrations. Didn't he know? The man in John chapter 5 has been infirmed. He could not move for how many years? 38 years. Jesus Christ knew that he has been in that condition for such a long time. So God knows your frustration. Step two, he comes to help. Jesus Christ knew his condition and he came to him and said, "Sir, do you really want to be made whole?" Question. Good question. He came to his help and he's coming to your help.
Amen.
So he came to Peter. Out of the two boats, why Peter's? Why did he come to Peter? Was that is step two of the five-step pattern that God uses to help anyone in need. Step three, he asks to use something that is yours to reach others. The wife of the prophet, the widow, that died in 2 Kings 4, and the husband died and left nothing for this woman. And the creditors were coming. The man of God said, "What do you have?" He asked to use something that is yours to reach others. He said, "Go borrow vessels." The vessels go borrow other vessels and begin to pour oil into it. And she began to pour oil to the point that when there are no more vessels, say, "Sir, the vessels are finished." Say, "Fine. The moment the vessels are finished, the oil also is gone." Say, "What do I do now?" "Go sell those vessels and pay your debt and use the remaining for yourself." He came to Simon Peter and borrowed his boat so that he can preach to others. Number four, step four. He returns what he borrowed or what he has borrowed and give you a personal instruction of what to do. After he had used the boat of Peter, Simon Peter, God will never leave you the same way he met you. Rather, he leaves you better. He said, "Launch out into the deep and let down your net for a catch." Step five. He gives you something in return. Verse 8. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, For I am a sinful man, O Lord. Doesn't that sound as if he was overwhelmed? He was flabbergasted by what has just happened. Suddenly the Lord turned his mourning into dancing. God will turn your mourning into dancing.
Amen.
Peter acknowledged his weakness as a believer. Peter was overwhelmed by the goodness of God. You will be overwhelmed by his goodness.
Amen.
Verse 9. For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of the fish which they had taken. Were these not the same people that toiled all night and caught nothing? And some few hours later, they got so much that their net was even breaking. That's why I know there is hope for you. That is why I know there's hope for you.
Amen.
If he says the downfall of a man,
it's not the end.
Who says you are falling? It's just a sleep.
Amen.
And even if you are falling, a righteous man will fall how many times? And will he stay there?
No.
He rise up again? So he will rise up again.
Amen.
In Acts chapter 15, when they heard the news of the letter that the church in Jerusalem sent to the church in Antioch about the new Gentiles that have turned to the Lord, that they should now abstain from blood and strangled things, they rejoiced by the encouragement. The word of God will encourage you.
Amen.
Verse 10. And so also were James and John, who are partners with Simon. Be careful who are your business partners. Because if they are not believers as you are, at this time is a good time to say, you don't know, boy, you don't know what you're doing. But they were in it together. And so James and John were partners with Simon, and Jesus said to Simon, do not be afraid. From now on, you will catch
men.
From nothing to something. 2 Kings chapter 5. Very good. 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 1. Now Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Syria, was a great and honorable man in the eyes of his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. He was also a mighty man of valor, but a leper. He had everything, but he was wealthy, but not healthy. Who says money can buy health? God gives health. Money can buy you medication. Who makes the medication to work?
God.
Because some people took the medication, but they are not healed. Verse 10. And Elisha sent a messenger to him. Who is him?
Naaman.
Saying, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times. How many times?
Seven times.
And your flesh shall be restored. And you shall be clean. Amen. God always come to our rescue.
Amen.
Verse 11. But Naaman became furious and went away. Remember the 5-step pattern that God uses to bring us out of our need. Remember? Why did Naaman become furious and went away? Obviously, he was not ready to follow the given instruction. Remember?
Yeah.
He wasn't ready. Can this be the problem of some of us today? Because when we are not ready to do as we are told by God, will God would that make God to shift? Isaiah said, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. So the land is good. Amen?
Amen.
The land where we are right now is a good land.
Amen.
Because God has put in this land resources to meet our needs.
Amen.
But not at the expense of God. In other words, not without obeying God. He said, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat. Naaman became furious and went away with what?
Nothing.
With his leprosy. Verse 13. But something happened. Something
happened.
And I know. You see? Something happened. Something is going to happen to you.
Amen.
Something good.
Amen.
Do you believe that?
Yes, sir.
Say, I believe.
I believe.
Faith comes by
hearing.
Hearing. Hearing. The word of God. And his servants came. Whose servants?
Naaman.
Came near and spoke to him. Thank God for good friends. And came to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do something great. Everybody say something great.
Something great.
If the prophet had told you to do something great. And I'm sure the same thing applies to us. If God has told us to do something great, many will do it. But most often, he doesn't ask us to do something great. He always asks us to do something simple. If, my father, if the prophet had told you to do something great, would you not have done it? How much more when he says to you, wash and be clean. In other words, God often instructs us not to do anything that we cannot do. It's often something that we can do. What God often tells us to do to get what we want in life are nothing biggie. They are for our own good. Verse 14. Are you following?
Yes.
So he went down. Thank God. Everyone say, thank God.
Thank God.
He went down. Excuse me. He dipped 7 times. What if he had dipped 1 time?
Nothing.
Nothing.
I tried. He did twice.
Nothing.
Because nothing came, he stopped. He did 3 times.
Nothing.
It is good to follow instruction, especially the instruction of God. He did 7 times, just as he was told, according to the saying of the man of God, and his flesh was restored, like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean.
Amen.
What if he had followed the instruction earlier? Could this be the delay of many miracles today?
Yes.
Could that be the conundrum you find yourself? What if Naaman had not done the 7 times? Would he have been healed?
No.
7 is 7. Could this be another reason why there are delays in divine blessing? John chapter 2, verses 1 to 3, very quickly. John chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Now both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. Jesus was sociable. Verse 3. So don't tell me that because we're Christians, we don't go to parties. Jesus was sociable. It is the type of party that you went that matters.
Mm-hmm.
Not just any party. Now, Jesus, verse 3, and when they ran out of wine in the party, they ran out of what? Wine. That was it. That's a big shame, isn't it? Because the guests are still coming. How do you want to tell them? The mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. But why did she come to Jesus to tell Jesus? Was Jesus the host? Jesus is also a guest, like any other guest. Would she have known something that we don't know?
Yes.
She knew that only God can take away shame. If God is going to change your situation, it has to be from what you know he can do. If anyone is to come to God, they should come to him because they believe that he is. And he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Why bother coming if you don't know what he can do?
Exactly.
That is the question. Have you been to parties where even the host or the hostess are not aware that food and drinks are finished? Yet, the friends were the ones that arranged among themselves to sort things out, to take away the shame.
Yes.
May God give you this sort of friends.
Amen.
Friends that will take away shame from coming to you. That was what the mother of Jesus did. And that's she came. We did not know who was the host, but we know that it must have been so close to Jesus' mother's heart. For her to have thought of it. Who else can bring us out of this shape but God? And she came to Jesus. Now remember the 5-step pattern God uses to answer our needs. Remember? Okay. Verse 5. His mother said to the servants, whatever he says to you, do it. I love that. Whatever he says to you, do it. If only Naaman knew this. For someone listening to this message or watching, between you and your next job, it's a 5-step pattern God will use to answer all your needs. Between now and then, there's a transition between empty and plenty. There's a transition between nothing and something. Between zero and hero, that's a transition. You follow this 5-step pattern that God uses. Because they are scriptural. They are sound. Verse 7. Jesus said to them, to who? Who are the deaf? the servants that are ready to walk. He said, fill the water pot with water. And they fill them up to the brim. No qualms. No squabbles. They did as they were told. It doesn't make sense. We run out of wine. They are saying we should fill it with water. They were not rationalizing the word. They did not rationalize it. They just did as they were told. Could we be the one delaying our own miracle by wondering how would this be?
Exactly.
It doesn't make sense, so I'm not going to do it.
Yes.
You've got to be fanatic about Jesus. Whatever he says, you do it. Some, like Simon, will put up an initial resistance. Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. And some, like Naaman, will also put up an initial fight. I thought he could use that. I thought he could just come and just roll up his hands and say, be healed. I thought he could just use other better rivers. Huh? Say, I should go to Jordan, the one for the poor people, over my dead body. And he became furious and went away. Whereas others would just get on with it and do as they were told. Which one do you belong to? In Romans chapter 14, verse 1, receive one who is weak in faith, but not to dispute over doubtful faith. I've noticed that people have dispute over doubtful things. People argue over things that are doubtful, not believable. Doubtful things are opinions. The New Living Translation says, accept other believers who are weak in faith. So I've attributed argument to a weakness of faith. Accept other believers who are weak in faith and don't argue with them about what they think is right or wrong. People argue over what they think is right or wrong. These are doubtful things. Like Simon Peter, after he had toiled all night and caught nothing. But the moment he stopped the dispute, the moment he stopped his own opinion, putting his own opinion to it, but allowing what God says to do it, what happened? Miracle came. The moment Naaman stopped his own opinion and stopped questioning, why didn't I use this? Why didn't he come here? Why didn't I go to that nice river? Why did I not do this today? Why were we doing this? The moment he stopped doing that opinion and argument over that opinion of his, what he thought is right or wrong, the moment he stopped that, what happened?
Miracle.
He was healed. He did not even argue how many times he should dip into the water. If he had said several times, excuse me, seven. I don't have the time, seven times. But thank God he did do it. So in John chapter 2, verse 7, Jesus said to them, fill the water pot with water. Did they say, why water?
No.
Maybe this God doesn't even listen well. Why water? Why water?
Oh, pardon?
And they filled them up to the brim. No argument. They were not disputing it or trying to ask, did he hear me well? Verses 8 to 10, please. And he said to them, draw some out now. Now. And take it to the master of the feast. Now is very important. But now is faith.
Yes.
Draw some out now. Not at your own time.
Right now.
And take it to the master of the feast. And they took it. Next verse, please. When the master of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine. When was it made wine? When?
Now.
The moment he said, put the water there in the water and draw it and serve it. That is the time. Now. Because now is faith. Many a times, the delay to our miracle comes because we don't do it now. Say, so today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your heart as in a day of provocation. Now, tomorrow might be late. When the master of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, we don't know when the water was made wine. But it was made wine. So it's not for you to know how it's going to be. You just follow the instructions. If Naaman had known this simple thing, he would have been healed earlier. The servant said, if the prophet had asked you to do something great, you would have done it. Why is it that even the small things have become so great to do? Great, difficult to do. When the master of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine and did not know where it came from, should he know? So is it? That's the master of ceremony. Not only the host and the hostess that did not know that they ran out of food and drink. Even the master of ceremony did not know that they ran out of wine. But the servants who had drawn the water knew. Ten lepers came to Jesus. Heal me, heal me, heal us. Jesus cried to them, go and show yourself to the priest. Because Jesus Christ knew that only the priest can confirm if leprosy has gone or not. And they went. As they went, they were healed.
Wow.
And one of them saw, many years of leprosy has gone. Why wouldn't I dance crazy? Do you know what I come under my skin? It's gone now. He came back to give thanks. Jesus Christ said, you are the only one that came. Where are the others? Even the one that came was a stranger. From nothing to something. Are you following?
Yes, sir.
Verse 10. And he said to him, every man at the beginning set out the good wine. And when the guests are well drunk, then they give them the inferior one. That's a good economics. You have kept the good wine until now. God will always have the last say.
Amen.
So don't be troubled by what you are going through. Look at him. looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was glory, joy that was set before him,
endured the shame.
Endured the cross, despised the shame. Why? Because he saw the glory. Can you see? Can you see the glory? It's only by faith. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 1. Quickly. And it came to pass when the Lord was about to take up Elijah into heaven by wild wind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. Verses 9 to 15. And so it was, when they had crossed over, that Elijah, the senior prophet, said to Elisha, the junior, ask what may I do for you before I am taken away from you. Elisha said, please, let a double portion of your spirit be upon me. Next verse. So he said, you have asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, remember that same was what Peter said.
Yes.
Nevertheless, at your word. This one said, nevertheless,
if you see me,
if you see me where I'm taken from you, it shall be so. But if not, it shall not be so. Then it happened. Everyone say it happened.
It happened.
It also happened.
Amen.
If you are willing
and obedient,
it will happen.
Amen.
You have said amen.
Yes, sir.
Because you know it will happen.
Amen. Yes.
And I say amen. So the onus is on you to make it happen. Then it happened. Once the agreement is in place, if you fulfill the agreement, it will happen. Then it happened. And this could be the reason why it has not happened. Because we are not keeping to the part of the agreement. As they continued on and talked, they both knew the agreement. So they continued. God knows your condition. You have prayed about it.
Yes, sir.
And you are holding on to his promises.
Yes.
And then he has given you a personal instruction of what to do. So the onus on you to do what he has said, just as he has said. If you say seven times, it's seven times. The mother of Jesus said, whatever he tells you to do,
do it.
Draw it now. Not when you are less busy. Time matters. King's business is to be done urgently. Then it happened as they continue on and talk that suddenly, it was suddenly. And it will happen suddenly. Paul. And Paul and Silas, Acts chapter 16, were locked in the prison, chained in the prison, in the inner prison, at midnight, when Paul and Silas began to pray and sing, suddenly,
amen.
Yes. What has happened to it? Suddenly. Then it happened. As they continue on and talk, that suddenly a chariot of fire appeared with horses and fire and separated the two. Who are the two?
Elijah and Elisha.
Separated them. God will soon separate you from the obstacle.
Amen.
Separated them.
Amen.
Whatever has been holding you down, God will separate you from
them. Amen.
Separated you.
Amen.
He separated them, the two of them, and Elijah went up by a wild wind, just as God has said, into heaven. And what happened? Next one, please. And Elisha saw it. What was the agreement? And Elisha saw it. And he cried out, "My father!" That was it. That was it. The pattern of those days. Right? They called their leaders father. See, my father, the chariot of Israel, because it's a school of prophets. They are all sons of prophets. So the father, the head prophet is their father. See? My father, the chariot of Israel and his horsemen. So he saw him no more. And he took hold of his own clothes and tore them into two pieces. Next verse, please. He also took up the mantle of Elijah, for he was asking for double portion of his spirit, that had fallen from him, and went back and stood by the bank of the Jordan. Next verse, please. Then he took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water and said, "Where is the Lord God of Elijah?" And when he also had struck the water, it was divided this way and that way, and Elisha crossed over. Next verse. Now when the sons of the prophet, people that are watching from a distance, when the sons of the prophet, people are watching you, you have been saying you go to church, you know God. Let's see what's going to happen to you. But God will answer for them. God will answer you. And when the sons of the prophet who are from Jericho saw him, they said, "The spirit of Elijah rests
on Elijah."
On Elisha.
Amen.
And they came to meet him, bowed
to the ground before him.
For nothing.
To something.
Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Unless you call on him, he will not save you. Jesus said, "No one comes to the Father except through me." It is possible to be a regular church attendant and still not be saved. To be saved, it is whoever calls on the name of the Lord. Whoever. You and I are the whoever. Verses 9 to 11. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe it in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Many of us need to be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. Your heart is so sacred. You believe rightly or you believe wrongly from your heart. The devil wants to hone your heart. God wants to hone your heart. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. You believe to do the right thing from your heart. Some people believe to do the wrong thing from their heart, because their heart is not from God. For with the heart, one believes unto righteousness. When you are saved, God gives you a new heart.
Amen.
That believe to right things, right doing. Right doing. And with the mouth, confession is made unto
salvation.
Salvation. So your mouth agrees with your heart. Your mouth confesses that Jesus is Lord. Yeah. That Jesus saved me. I am a sinner. I am not obeying your word. And it is coming from your heart. Your heart believes that what you are saying is right, and you start believing from your heart to do the right thing, to live right, to follow Jesus. When you study the Bible, you do as you have been told. The five-step pattern. And you will be saved.
Amen.
Next verse, please. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. So when whoever calls God to save him or her, God will answer and save that person and give that person an inheritance. God will now take that person through the five-step pattern that God uses to bring, that will bring that person from nothing to something. Daniel was put in the den of lion, Daniel 6. And they brought him out, and there was no harm done to him because he believed in his God. Let us pray. Do you want God to help you? Do you want God to save you first? I think you need to be saved. You need to come to claim to God. I'm a sinner, Lord. I've not been doing what you said I should do. I am heading. I have it my own way. But now, Lord, I am sorry. Make that a prayer. I want to be born again. Jesus Christ said, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. John 3:3. And in verse 5, he said, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. You have to first see before you enter. The kingdom of God is at hand. You only need to be saved. Then God will take you free from nothing to something. Then your vision for the year can still be accomplished. If only you will believe. If only you are willing and obedient to do His will. Ask Him to save. Ask Him, I want to be born again. Those that are saved are the ones that are born again. And their names are written in the book of life. It's not those that come to church. It is those that are saved by Him. So a book shall be opened, the book of life. And anyone's name that is not in the book of life, Revelation 21. Anyone whose name is not there, so your attempt, your first goal is for your name to be there. Ask Him. Save me. Whoever come to me, Jesus said, I will not wise cast away. You are a youth. You are a mother. You are a father. To ask Him to save me. I want to be saved. So whoever calls on Him, calls on the Lord, shall be saved. You are the Lord. Call Him. Ask Him to save me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And He will give you an instruction. He has shown you that, old man, what to do. Follow the instruction. Follow the instruction. Follow the given instruction. No qualms, no squabble. Follow the instruction. And enjoy it now. Follow the instruction. And it will come back to us. Let me begin to thank God for answering prayer. Begin to thank God for answering prayer. If He has saved you, He will know. He will give you a new heart. He will give you a new heart. With the heart, man believes unto right doing. And you begin to do things right. You begin to study the Bible. You begin to size yourself up. You begin to do what you are told. You begin to follow His instruction. And then you will laugh at the end. You will laugh at the end. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you. We give you praise. For those that have been saved, thank you. that your name shall not be deleted from the book of life. Your name shall not be removed from the book of life. Tell it, whatever it tells you to do, you will do it.
Yes.
From nothing to something. From nothing to something. From nothing to something. He will take you. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Clap your hands together for the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.